Dear colleagues, so good afternoon. I hope you already enjoyed your lunch. And now we come into the session A3, which is dedicated to the theoretical part of the pattern recognition and information processing. So now I would like to give a floor to our distinguished session chairman, Professor Aleksey Kharin. So, Professor, you have a floor now.
Okay, thank you for giving me a word for introduction. So our session is related to many things, to pattern recognition and classification first, to knowledge-based expert and decision support systems second, and also to application of pattern recognition. According to the schedule, we have six presentations. I can identify authors of five of them here, and I hope the presenter of the talk number five will appear, if not yet. So we are trying to go on the schedule, and according to it, the first talk is by Liudmila Cheremisinova and Dmitry Cheremisinov on correctness of control systems with concurrency behavior. Yes, please.
Good afternoon, colleagues. So I want to demonstrate and would like to present the topic correctness of control system with concurrent behavior. The considered task is functional verification of digital systems with parallelism of behavior. And verification we understood as checking whether an implementation of the control system conforms to the function specified on its specification. This task is very important because of digital systems grows very quickly. And so the complexity of testing tends to grow and grow faster than the complexity of design. Verification would have a result to find out all bugs in the implementation. That is exhaustive simulation, but exhaustive simulation supposes that we reach each state and all possible input combinations of input signal. But this task is exponential on complexity. And the outcome is to restrict this process, so do it within a visible type. And one of the ways to restrict the exhaustive simulation is to generate test pattern that cover restricted area of all patterns. For example, to generate patterns that cover only those area of function in the system that is reflected in its specification. So we use model-based testing. In model-based testing, the testers are generated from its specification. Then we have implementation of the control system that we seen as a black box. Its internal structure is not accessible for us, but it can be fed by test patterns, and we can see the outcome of fulfilling these tests. And if all patterns are good and the outputs of test stimuli and outputs of the implementation are equal, so the SAT set under test conforms to its model reflected in its specification. And the object of our consideration are reactive control systems with concurrent behavior. That system have the following peculiarities. First, continuous signal exchange with external environment. And the second, concurrence of the processes occurring in the system. So in that case, we have so-called true concurrency, when concurrency is reflected in the specification. Such reflective systems are asynchronous in the nature, but they have many implications in communications protocols and in industry when we have industrial algorithm of control. The well-known ways to describe control systems are finite state machines and labeled transition systems, but the languages have not all expressive means to reflect true concurrency. The models that reflect true concurrency are connected with Petri nets. That is the known methods to reflect true parallelism. So the languages of colored Petri nets are used, and parallel automata and parallel algorithms too. Methods for pattern generation based on traversing automaton graph or reachability graph for Petri nets, but the methods based on state explosion, and we propose the method of simulating reflective control system with concurrent behavior without these difficulties. What suggested? The goal is to generate test sequences for verification of reactive system with true parallelism. We solve the following problems. What can be language to be able to explicitly reflect true parallelism in specification? And how to verify control systems with parallelism without exhaustive computation? How to organize verification of system with concurrency behavior using sequential computation? And how to generate test sequences that ensure visible time limits generation and good coverage the area of system functioning. And we suggest to use Pralu language for describing parallel control algorithm. And we use this language not only for system design specification, but for describing behavior on the object controlled by the design system. That we use Pralu protocol for describing the control system as a whole. That is control algorithm, control device, and the controlled environment too. Then we propose to use specification for restriction the area that should be covered by verification. Then dynamically the process of simulation. Then we generate test sequences dynamically in the process of simulation and debugging the specification before its implementation. Parallel control algorithm in Prolog. So the main features of this language, it uses another set of chains. Each chain has initial and terminal chain labels, so-called partial states. Partial is considered as states that can be simultaneously. So the full state consists of several partial states. All variables of the algorithms are Boolean, and we used there is two basic operations in Prolog algorithm: waiting and acting operation. Waiting for the time when the conjunction is equals one, and acting assigning values to variables from the conjunction. So the chains can be executed concurrently or alternately. Alternate branching, that is one of the chains can be fulfilled in the next moment of time. Here is a simple example of parallel algorithm that describes the cycle of manipulator that moves from right to left and from the left to the right. It reacts to the external signals only in right-hand position. Then if the button enable was pressed, then it continue its motion. When the button disable is pressed, then it stops. So the algorithm is very simple. It contains two concurrently executed chains. One chain defines the control stimuli for manipulator, and states pressing the buttons. The problem is how to simulate reactive systems that have parallel processes using sequentially operated means. And we suggest interpret Prolog algorithm by a transistor level model. For this, the interleaving parallelism model is used. Concurrency we understood as the ability to order operation in arbitrary way. Then the semantics of waiting and acting operation is refined. The refinement extends the definition of partial order of implementation to a linear order. Then we organize algorithm interpretation, the notions. And to organize algorithm interpretation, we introduce the notions of branches and their quinius. And to organize process of branch execution, waiting and acting operations are considered as compositions of some elementary operations. To synchronize branches execution, the barrier mechanism is introduced. In such interpretation, Prolog algorithm can be executed in linear time. That is the property of linearity we provide. Data structure. Data structure of Prolo algorithm in TLM model consists of two vectors of variable values. One vector current values and the second planned values. That is values for the next cycle of simulation. And so the operation are introduces on vector components. The central notion of simulation of scheduling procedures of computation with linear ordering is a branch and subprocesses. Branch is understood as a set of sequential subprocesses that start with a given operation and can be executed in parallel. Branch is dynamic object that can be formed, terminate, executed, and suspended. To organize, to schedule the processes of executing branches, the notion of quinius is introduced. The quinio of ready branches for execution and the quinio of waiting branches. That is the ready for execution branches are fulfilled in the present cycle and the way quinio that the branches that will be executed in the next cycle. Так, barrier mechanism. The barrier mechanism at the points where operation must be suspended. The central point of the barrier mechanism is the agreement about the duration of the language operation. We use the assumption that all operations have zero duration. Using these assumptions, all the branches are executed until they can. The end is when it demands the new values of variables. The algorithm of simulation. Branches are sequentially extracted from the quinio of ready branches and fulfilled. If the quinio of ready branches becomes empty, the barrier is reached. So branches from waiting quinio transferred to the branches of ready quinions. We enter the next values of input variables as planned ones and then send planned values to the current values. So we are ready to execute the next cycle. And that such a system operates branches to the end. So we propose methodology of constructing test system based on parallel language that consists of transforming the Prolo algorithm to the TLM model, then functioning reactive system is described as Prolo language, and in the Prolo we describe the system as a whole and debugging, and then we debug the integrated description of the system. Here is an example the considered simple example of manipulator, we add the description of the behavior of environment. So if we consider the system as a whole, we have 10 simple branches. In the first moment, we have 3, 1, 2, 3, and we have two vectors of variables. The first variables belong to an environment, and 3, 1 to the control algorithm. So here is a simple example of generating test patterns. Here is steps or cycles of simulation, branches, queues of ready for execution, queues of waiting, current values, and planned values of all variables. So the current values are stimuli in the test pattern, and planned values are results of simulation. So we can generate test sequences using simulating debugging that algorithm. And we have only two outer variables when we simulating the system as a whole. That is the sensors, signal from sensors of the system. And all conclusion. A methodology for constructing a test system is proposed, which allows generating a test sequence in the process of debugging specification of reactive control system presented in Prolog language. There is a software support of the methodology, simulation and debugging tools for Prolog language, and synthesizes for Prolu language in the hardware model in the Verilog and C languages. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention. Please, questions?
Thank you for the presentation. Unfortunately, it was too long, about 10 minutes more. So we don't have time for questions. And we directly switch to the next presentation, number 2, which is by Aleksey Rozhnov, on some trends in updating the nomenclature of specialties of researchers in the areas of research methods and means of intellectualization. Yes, please.
Dear colleagues, good afternoon. It is a great privilege for me to participate in conference with all of you together. For familiarization, I propose a brief message on the theme Some Trends in Updating the Nomenclature of Specialties of Researchers in the Areas of Research Methods and Means of Intellectualization. Background of involvement in the problem and why, an invitation to participate in writing an article for the Great Russian Encyclopedia Artificial Intelligence in Russia. The possible interest in this topic is due to the problems of system integration. As part of the paper, we do not consider in general artificial intelligence domain. The focus is on intellectualization as a process with two or more control methods, including such individual functions can be naturally interpreted in the subject area of pattern recognition. It is necessary to take into account not only local problems to achieve qualitatively new results in the field of artificial and hybrid intelligence, but also requires to make their generalization in the context of popularization. In the subject area, we will focus our attention on two aspects. Greater transparency needed. Guardrails essential. motifs, greater transparency needed. Artificial and hybrid intelligence technologies are dramatically changing people's lives. Therefore, we should combine our efforts to increase the transparency of the processes of developing new technologies. Guardrails essential. We cannot afford to continue playing catch-up regarding AI, allowing its use with limited or no boundaries or oversight and dealing with the almost inevitable society consequences after the fact. No matter how we talk about the definitions of artificial intelligence, the legislator is ahead of us. So the following slides show the definitions of artificial intelligence and artificial intelligence technologies in accordance with one of the new existing laws, on the example of the legislation of the Russian Federation. So, why do we give such examples? Along with the advanced legislative initiatives, other derived regulatory documents are also undergoing changes. In accordance with the topic of the report, the specialties of the relevant researchers within the new nomenclature are also classified as such. So, of course, the essence of the report is not lengthy arguments about the next definition of AI, taking into account the encouraging wording of the reviewers and with gratitude for their support, the emphasis on the predominance of popularization in the relevant intentions is outlined. A routine review of the updated content of the nomenclature of researcher specialties is published in the printed report. Therefore, goal orientation implies the key question, what do we objectively do not know about AI and do not relate to AI in the foreseeable future? Short-term and medium-term prospects are assumed in this case. Software implemented services of a high degree of automation, informatization, intellectualization, etc. already today have a significant impact on the processes of creation, production and distribution of goods and services for economic and cultural purposes, and in the future this influence is more than likely to increase significantly. The following three slides present arguments on the problems of the technological gap in the field of AI and the conditions for capacity building. The interpretation of new technologies and the various integration components under the auspices of AI can already be presented at this stage not only as a multipurpose technology, but also as a set of super large data sets organized in a very specific way and used for representation. Such practical results in the aggregate of accumulated information resources, relevant services and technologies have been, are and will continue to be increasingly used in both the economic and social spheres. More information about this and related materials can be found in the profile project in ResearchGate. Technological gap in the field of new technologies and futures of intellectual property protection of systems with reliable science of artificial intelligence in Russia. So, due to the dynamic development of the situation that has arisen, a significant number of problematic issues appear, although many of them are obviously outside the intellectual property, IP policy, and are related, for example, to such areas as labor policy, ethics, human rights, etc. So, in conclusion, a number of priority issues are proposed, slides 14 and 15. Responsibility for administrative decisions in the field of intellectual property. Discussion points and the context of capacity building. See more details, final slide 16. Application research directions of the scientific specialty 1.2.1, artificial intelligence and machine learning. Pre-finals closes. The short-term perspective includes specialized accentuation, addresses the issue of cognitive semantics aspects that cannot be represented by traditional digital and logical means, discusses necessary conditions for purposeful and sustainable convergence of decision-making. One of the most interesting and rapidly implemented applications of artificial intelligence technologies is in the field of registration and protection of intellectual property rights. For interested researchers, indicative questions are given responsibility for administrative decisions in the field of intellectual property, IP. What measures in the field of IP policy could be taken to help contain or reduce the technological gap in terms of AI capacity? What forms of cooperation between countries with a similar level of technology development in the field of AI and IP could be? Generalizing emphasis, discussion points, and the context of capacity building is presented here. In particular, the application presents the research directions of the scientific specialty 1.2.1, artificial intelligence and machine learning. Draft passports of scientific specialties, nomenclature of scientific specialties unpublished. Printed version available, Higher Attestation Commission of the Russian Federation, access mode without restrictions. Thank you for your attention. Дякую за увагу. Dear colleagues, I do not speak English well. Please write your questions in the Zoom chat.
Спасибо.
Okay. So thank you very much for your presentation. Спасибо за доклад.
Да, спасибо большое.
Уважаемые коллеги, dear colleagues, do you have questions? I could translate them. No questions. So I can look into the chat. Nothing. Okay, so if nothing, then we would like to thank the presenter again, and we have 5 minutes back from the 10 used extra, so we are just have 5 minutes lag according to the schedule in total, and according to the schedule. The next presentation is by me, so I'm here not a guest and especially not a distinguished guest, but just one of the speakers and also doing some advertising notes or work. Okay, so the next talk is by me on robustification of sequential statistical decision rules for stochastic data flows analysis. This is the joint work with my colleagues, and I now share my screen. Okay, so this is about the presentation. I will try to be quick. Well, the talk is about statistical decision rules, namely about sequential statistical decision rules. The aspects of their robustification, and those decision rules are applied for analysis of stochastic data flows. The work is with my former PhD student Thuan Tha Tu from University of Da Nang from Vietnam, and with my current two master students, Dai Yu Kun and Wang Yumi. Well, the contents is indicated here. So we considered three models of data flows, and we considered two problem settings in terms of simple hypothesis and in terms of composite hypothesis. Well, and the sequential approach is a powerful tool for construction of statistical decision rules on parameters of stochastic data flows in many areas, especially in medicine, in quality control, in finance, and others. These sequential statistical decision rules are optimal for hypothetical models. But in practice, the data we observe in data flows are usually deviate from the preset hypothetical model. So the problem of performance characteristics analysis under distortion and the problem of robustification of sequential statistical decision rules is important. There are a number of attempts to attack this problem. There are two directions. The first one is simple models, shrinking neighborhoods, and a very limited number of papers in this direction. The other one is empirical robustification in the areas related to applications. In this talk, we try to solve this problem theoretically for more or less rich class of models. We start with the very simple model of the data flow with independent, identically distributed observations. On a probability space omega fp, taking values in a set u, which is discrete, with a probability distribution 1, where hypotheses are simple. It means that we exactly formulate which value takes the parameter. Not a set of values, but just one point. One point against another point. So the decision rule can be written in form of 2, where lambda n is the log likelihood ratio statistic. D equals 0 or 1 means that we stop the observation process and accept the corresponding hypothesis. D equals 2 means that the next observations need to be made because we don't have enough information to guarantee the requested accuracy in terms of error probabilities of type 1 and 2. Alpha 0 and beta 0, using them we calculate the parameters of the decision rule or of the test, the parameters C minus and C plus indicated in 3. Suppose that the hypothetical model is contaminated and the factual probability distribution bar pk is a mixture of the hypothetical version and of a contaminating distribution with an unknown probability of outlier presence. So for this situation, we propose a family of modified sequential tests, 5, with 2 more parameters, G minus and G plus, which are, in fact, the truncation parameter for the test statistic. To analyze robustness quantitatively, we introduce the following robustness characteristics. The risk functional as a weighted sum of error probabilities, the guaranteed upper risk functional, which is defined as a supremum of the values of the risk, over all admissible distortions. And we define the robustness Minimax criterion, it means the functional under constraint size, the expected number of observations. Okay, hope that I'm back again. The situation was also extended to different types of distortions. For the distortions that can be formulated in L1 metric, also in L2 metric, and weighted C metric. We don't go into details here, but the other model of data that was considered is inhomogeneous data following the model of time series with a parametric trend indicated here. The similar results are presented for that model also. So the characteristics of the tests are calculated under distortions, and the minimax robust sequential test or decision rule is constructed. The similar results also obtained for the data with dependencies, especially here we have results presented for Markov chain model. The hypotheses are formulated according to about the parameters of the observed Markov chain, about the vector of initial probabilities, and of about the matrix of the one-step transition probabilities. Suppose that this model is also contaminated. We propose to use a family of the tests with the test statistics lambda and g with 2 times n+1 parameters. And again, these parameters can be chosen to construct the minimax robust sequential test. Theorem 4 gives impression how much deviate the characteristics of the test from the hypothetical versions. So here we have deviations of order 1 on the contamination level. In the numerical example, we compared the sequential probability ratio test with the constructed here minimax robust test. And the results you may see at figure 1. The black curve is for the classical test, the blue one is for the minimax robust test. Here you may see the dependency of half sum of two error probabilities on the contamination level. And in figure 2, we see what we pay for the gain in accuracy and robustness. Similar results were also obtained for the case of composite hypothesis setting. Well, I will not go into details here, but we'll just show you the main results. Theorem 6 gives asymptotic expansions for the expected sample size and the probability of hypothesis acceptance under condition that the parameter being fixed. Corollaries 1 and 2 give the expressions for error type 1 and 2 probabilities and also for the conditional and total expected sample size. Here you can see how does the error probability grows with the contamination increasing. The asymptotics of the characteristics for the sequential decision rules in this model are given in theorems 7 and 8 here. So error type 1 and 2 probabilities are analyzed in equations 14 and 15, and the expected sample sizes are given here. So again, for this model, following the same methodology, the robust sequential test was constructed. And how much do we get from it? We can discuss using these two figures. On figure 2, you may see the dependencies of error probability on the truncation level. So the bigger error is, the more essential truncation is, the more essential modification we do. For example, if we have contamination with the probability 0.05, then with rho equals to 0.8, we get almost 2 times gain in accuracy, and we pay for this. We pay for this in terms of the expected number of observation, just one extra observation, which is not bad. Well, I will not give much words for conclusion. I will just tell that the results are also applied for monitoring of medical data for the quickest sequential detection of the individual efficiency of used medication scheme for patients, and also in monitoring of the epidemiologic process in Belarus for typical scenario identification. I would like to thank all of you for attention. There are some references, and really we do have some time for questions, but not too much. Do you have questions? If yes, please. So no questions. Okay, if we don't have, then we go according to the schedule to the next position, which is presentation number 4. And it should be by Valerian Ivashenko, Nikita Zotov, or Maxim Orlov. And we'll be on semantic logic of repeating events in a forward branching time model. Please.
Good afternoon. Do you see my screen? It's okay. I want to present my report about semantic logic of repeating events and a forward branching time model. I want to say, excuse me, perhaps, and excuse my slides, which have perhaps a non-formal style. But so begin. My report consists some parts, and I want to tell about the topic and approaches to solve it, some tasks which connected with this topic, and our proposition, our models and algorithms. Semantic loading is an introspective mechanism capable to support process introspection. It is important because it is useful to achieve such goals as process mining and explanation of problem solving. Also, there are several aspects explored by approaches to semantic loading. I select such aspects as space-time model of processes, type of semantic log data structures, and specifics of the processes which to be logged. Time structures can be various, and this slide demonstrates linear structure, forward branching tree, backward branching tree, and directed acyclic structure. The topic is concerning the linear and forward branching tree, and linear as subcase. From the point of view of data structures, we deal with partially persistent structures, fully persistent structures, and confluently persistent structures. And in this report, we are restricted with the fully persistent data structures. Information and knowledge processing environment can have own specific, and there are environment without local or global stage storage, which can be accessed unbounded number of times, without global storage, but with a local storage, which cannot store a global state of the environment, and with global storage, which can be accessed unbounded number of times and store global states of the environment. We concentrate on the second two cases. Our approach may be compared with the existing approaches, which you can find in published papers. Mainstream approach initially starts with the sequence of process events and try to determine the wide set of k types of events, and finally events are logged and specified depending in its type in the log structure. Our approach is opposite. Initially, we have a knowledge base capable to describe the events of the process. These events are reduced to basic types of events. And finally, need to log these events. As for repeating events, these events naturally occur in processes with a locally cyclic space-time structure. Our approach is use unified semantic knowledge representation. This representation model uses semantic networks and has ability to represent non-factor of knowledge, ability to represent events, phenomena and processes. And all events in this model are reduced to actual or non-actual membership relations of the semantic code set model. For example, this slide contains examples of semantic networks which describe knowledge processing states as semantic network. Semantic log structure in our approach, it is also a semantic network which has hierarchic and network structure. This slide contains illustration. This structure consists of simple structures of links of semantic logs. This structure is built on the principle of triple free stack structure. It is similar to binomial heap, but there are some differences. This structure grows incrementally, and the structure preserves linear order of events. The implementation of our approach is oriented for the integration platform, which has client server architecture and has a multi-tier architecture for knowledge driving systems. Client server architecture consists of variety virtual machine and ontology virtual machine, which interact each other. Key semantic log tasks are event identification task, log construction task, log navigation tasks, and such tasks which can be called as problems: anteriority problem and last common event problem. Acyclic structures, we have four cases of anteriority. It is antecedence when the first event precedes second. Consequence, it is opposite case. Coincidence, when two events are identical, and alternativeness, when not precede each other, don't precede. And for example, in cyclic structures, we have five cases where each both events are dependent. Primary log event task, it is task to find the primary event in the log. Last common event task, it is to find corresponding events. On this slide, it is showed with the green color. There are also basic navigation tasks. There is get event by log index number, to find event by identifier, and to get event identifier. In the case of repeating events, we deal with event repetitions, which also need to be identified, and we need to some additional navigation, solve additional navigation tasks for repeating events. For this slide illustrates two events which repeat this a long time, and we can ask the system to sequentially access of these repetitions. To solve this task, we propose a model which considers sets of events, identifiers, descriptor structures, log structures, natural numbers, and truth values. And also, this model contains functions which need to be evaluated to solve this task. Tasks, these functions is are showed in this slide. Also, several algorithms were developed and implemented. Our implementation was made using in the integration platform, and all developed algorithms have sublinear time complexity. Thank you for your attention. Perhaps some any questions?
Yes, thanks to the speaker for the presentation, for keeping the schedule, and we have time for one very short question, if any. So no questions appear. Also, the chat is empty. So we move to the next presentation. We're still 5 minutes behind the schedule. The next presentation will be, I don't know for now, by Mikita Shuldal or by Alexander Vasilyevich Tuzikov, maybe by Mikita, on development of molecular autoencoders as a generator of protein inhibitors. And this will be the application for prediction of potential drugs against coronavirus. Yes, please.
Can I share my screen, right? So, is it all good? Is my screen visible?
Yes, it's fine, Nikita, please.
All right. Yeah, so good time of the day, everyone. So as it has been mentioned, the work that I'll be presenting is called the development of molecular autoencoders as generators of protein inhibitors and its application for prediction of potential drugs against SARS-CoV-2. So this is a sneak peek at our team. We're based in the United Institute of Informatics Problems and the Institute of Bioorganic Chemistry. And our main area of expertise is computer modeling of novel drugs. So without much further ado, let's jump into the pipeline of modeling drugs. So here is a rather general way of doing drug design. usually, each disease is connected to some protein, which actually needs to be enhanced or silenced by a compound that we call a drug. And in order to find the best compound candidate for the target protein, one should screen existing compound databases or generate new compounds and estimate compound fitness to the protein using a set of molecular docking methods. What we did in our work is we actually developed a deep generative model, and we tried to incorporate it into the pipeline that's shown on the slide. So this way we're capable of enriching the compound sets at early stages of computer modeling. So the basic idea was to be able to, as I mentioned, enrich existing pipelines with the new potential inhibitors based on the ones that had already been identified in the screening procedure. As is the case with this model, we're not restricted to database compounds only, which is a restriction for screening methods usually. And we also are capable of getting away a little bit from the bias of the so-called pharmacophore models that are built for the screening. Hence we had the following motivations for using generative models. First of all, a very well-known and common approach in drug design is actually similarity search, but it enables finding new compounds only, so to speak, around a set of selected compounds for similarity search, right? While our model actually allows for more thorough examination of the molecular space. And not only that, but it also enables us to quote-unquote generate good generate compounds from good parts of the space. We can capitalize on the pre-computed value of the free binding energy for the compounds used in the training model. And we can try to identify parts of the space where the good compounds, the good binders actually are. And finally, we can use other compounds, for example, from the test data set to generate new compounds from. So let's quickly touch upon the types of data that we fed to our model. So there are molecular fingerprints, which are a well-known type of a way of vectorizing molecular data. And they are used a lot in supervised problems or for the similarity search itself. However, they have one big flaw, which is actually that having a fingerprint, there is no easy way to restore the original compound, or compounds, which the fingerprint belongs to. So this becomes especially crucial when dealing with compounds that might not be found in databases, or in case of generative models in particular. So in our work, we used Smiles notation of chemical structures, or vectorized Smiles notation to be precise. And it had a lot of benefits that come with it. So first of all, Smiles representation is a string representation, strictly speaking. So we can actually apply some common techniques from NLP, natural language processing, including the vectorization part, and also the use of LSTM networks that are, of course, very well fitted for the sequential data. And of course, Smiles embodies both qualitative and quantitative aspects of the model. So moving forward, to quickly give you an idea of the pre-processing conducted, we had to reduce the Smiles data set to that only containing drug-like atoms and compounds overall. Also filtering out some Smiles based on the length distribution and other factors. We got rid of duplicates and molecules with huge molecular weight. And in the end, Smiles were vectorized in order to be able to be fed to the model itself. So actually we developed two models. So the first one is sort of a vanilla autoencoder that uses a reconstruction error and is basically aimed at being able to reconstruct the original, to reconstruct on the output the original vectorized Smiles it was given. So the second model is more interesting. It's actually a semi-supervised autoencoder model. So it has an additional neuron on the latent layer, and it's responsible for the ligand protein interaction energy, which you usually call binding energy. And during the model's training, a predicted value of this free binding energy is passed to the neuron on the latent layer. So this, as you can notice, this neuron is not connected to the encoder part. It's only connected to the decoder part. So this is done so that the decoder, instead of trying to derive the binding energy or binding properties of the compounds from the embeddings, we'll simply get this value from the neuron. And actually, in the generation turn, it will be able to reproduce various compounds with energy close to the one that was passed to the neuron, passed to the given energy. So what actually both of these models allow us to achieve is to create a molecular space on the latent layer, or a so-called embedding space, or molecular embeddings to be precise for our case. So it's particularly useful and a very well-known concept in natural language processing. And we are doing a very similar thing here. So we create a space that various metrics can be introduced in, and compounds with similar properties are supposed to be close to each other in this space. But a very important thing is that we also project the properties of compounds in terms of the binding affinity to the molecular target to this space when considering a semi-supervised model. So it's important to note that we also trained an additional regression model to predict the binding energy values of generated inhibitors, generated compounds. And it was done to improve the capacity, to improve our capacity of promising compounds that we can actually then evaluate with the molecular docking. So this way you can generate thousands of compounds, then quickly predict their binding energies, and then set a compromising threshold so that we are able to pick up only those compounds which are feasible to dock in a chosen period of time. Later on, we end up having four metrics that we actually saw the evaluated the results through. So the first one is, as I mentioned, the predicted energy. So we, of course, had to first of all evaluate our energy prediction model, and second of all, we used the model actually to filter out some generate compounds in order to dock only the ones that are more promising. So the second metric is actually a generated energy. So it only applies to the semi-supervised model, and is basically a preset threshold of energy that we wanted to generate new compounds with. The third metric is source compound energy. So this metric is connected to the type of generation, where we used other compounds to sample new compounds from. So we basically computed their embeddings, and then we added some noise to the embeddings themselves, and then tried to restore the new compound. And the fourth metric is actually our benchmark. So we evaluated the binding energy affinities at this point with the docking, with molecular docking, in particular the Autodock Vena software. And it was our main judge, so to speak. So what do we actually have? So as I mentioned, we had two models, and we used two generation methods for both of the models. So the first method of generation was just generation from random numbers, which were drawn from normal distributions where the parameters were derived using the taste data distribution on the late layer, of course. And the second generation method was using source compounds, as I described previously. So if you look at the first model, the first row is a Bennings model. It's an unsupervised model. And we simply generated new compounds from random vectors passed to the latent layer. So despite the fact that this model doesn't take advantage of neither source compounds for generation nor any binding energy values, it's actually capable of generating new potential inhibitors of the chosen target by just merely generating compounds from the Bennings distribution inferred from the training data. So as you can see, we have more than 28% of the compounds generated with an energy low than -8 kilocalories per mole, which is actually quite decent. And the best candidate from that set so far is -10.6 kilocalories per mole. So the second method utilizes, it's again an unsupervised model, but instead of generated from random compounds, from random vectors, I should say, we have compounds from the test set. We compute embeddings for them, and then we add some noise to those embeddings and try to restore the compounds. And obviously, they are different to the ones that were used as source compounds. So yeah, this method utilizes compounds available, and the share of generated compounds with high binding affinity is actually considerably larger to the first generation method, with 38% of compounds exhibiting the predicted values of binding energy less than -8 kilocalories per mole, and 4% showing the energies lower than -9 kilocalories per mole. Going to the semi-supervised model, the first generation method again is just generation from noise. However, at this point we have a neuron that's responsible for the energy, so we can pass different energy thresholds to that neuron. So this model actually utilizes a version of style and content disentanglement, which is a common trick in computer vision, but for molecular data. So according to the results obtained, 31 and 64% of generated compounds show the value of binding energy with the deviations of 1 and 2 kilocalories per mole accordingly to the energy thresholds that had been set for that. And more than 27% of the compounds showed an energy of better than -8 kilocalories per mole, and 17.4% lower energies than the original threshold that was set. So the last model and last generation method, it's a combination of the semi-supervised model and the generation from the source compounds. So it actually proved to generate the top compounds throughout all four generation methods. And 52% of generated compounds are located within just 1 kilocalorie per mole deviation from the source compounds, while 16% of generated compounds has values of binding energy lower than -9 kilocalories per mole, and more than 40% lower than -8 kilocalories per mole. So let's look at some other statistics. So as mentioned, another machine learning model was implemented in order to predict the binding energy of generated compounds. And as you can see, we have a quite good correlation of this predicted energy and binding energy estimation by the docking procedure. So that's nice. If we look later on, so on the plot above, you can see it's model number generation method 4. You can see three distributions: the distribution of predicted energy, of energy estimated by docking, and the source compound energy. So actually, in this case, we generated new compounds from some source compounds. So as it seems in the beginning, we actually are doing a worse job in comparison to the source compounds, right? But you know, since obviously errors accumulate on different steps of this long pipeline, it does not play to our advantage, meaning that the model is affected by the errors in the docking software prediction, and it usually is affected to the worse side of the error, not to the better side of the error. And you know, it would be a miracle if we could generate compounds that are only better, but the results are still fascinating. If you look at the second plot, which is a distribution of difference of source compound energy minus generated compounds energy, you can see that though the average, the mean of the distribution lies around 1 point something, right? So we, on average, we generate compounds which are 1 point something kilocalories per mole worse. You can see there are a lot of compounds which are actually better. So if you look to the left of zero, you can see that there is quite a few compounds that actually possess an energy which is better than the preset threshold or the source compound energy. And even if this percentage is small, we can still benefit from it immensely. As you know, we need to focus only on the best compounds, of course. We conducted a lot of experiments, including experimenting with various thresholds for free for the binding energy neuron on the latent layer. As it can be seen here, there is a lot to improve. However, there is a visible difference in the distribution for different thresholds, and lower thresholds produce distributions which possess lower energies overall on average. Another interesting observation can be found on this plot, where all Vina energy, generation energy, and source compound energy are depicted. We can observe that with lower energies, lower energies are of course better. We see less variance through the compounds that have been generated. So it actually reinforces the concept of generation from the certain parts of the molecular or embedding space, and you know, clearly it gets more challenging to generate better compounds. However, we can do it more precisely, as the variance is lower, as you can see here. So I think this is it. Thank you for the attention and for your time.
Okay, thanks for an interesting presentation. Not too much time for questions, but the topic is quite interesting, so maybe there is one question.
May I ask someone?
Of course, yes, please.
So, my understanding is you're just using autoencoders to sort of compress the data, the original data, and then to generate from that. Once you get the decision, you train autoencoder, then you put some random numbers, say, and trying to some explore the space of your problem. It's correct.
Yeah. Basically, this is correct.
Okay. Okay. Then the question is. The question is, okay, you are using nonlinear model. And then, by the way, that's secondary, but by the way, you are using TSNE, TSNE, just to convince yourself that the results are good. They are close in feature space, but it's also non-linear. So it's something like you're deforming your space to get the nice result, nothing else. Just some sort of lying to yourself. It's non-linear model. Okay, then what about the idea you're just using the same, but instead of this autoencoder, you're using linear method like PCA. Okay, you get your data, you convert them to principal component, you take the major ones, which are much, much smaller, and then you always have the way to convert that small to original one. So by definition of the principal component analysis, any component, say original variable, could be reconstructed from principal components with very small error. Can you comment on that, please?
Yeah, I can. So first of all, there was a little bit of misunderstanding, as we didn't use TSNE. It was just an example.
Okay, that's secondary. Don't worry.
So we there's a lot of things to explore, of course. We did not really, as of now, put a lot of effort into exploring the latent space and actually whether or how well it is capable of compressing the molecular space. So the main incentive was to just be able to use this semi-supervised model. It's actually the one that we ended up using. And being able to do conditional sampling. So not only we want to generate from random numbers, we want to set an energy threshold, let's say minus 8 kilocalories per mole, and then only then pass random numbers, as well as use other source compounds in order to generate compounds with a preset property of good binding energies. So there's actually a lot of work to do with the exploration of the latent space. But yeah, the main incentive was just to be able to capitalize on the data. So we have a lot of data, molecular data with already estimated binding energies, and we want our model to look at the data and try to generate new compounds, which are actually better than the data that we have, or at least as good as the best compounds in the data that we have are.
Okay. So actually, by brute force, we can produce all the possible combination, and this looks realistic. Well, it doesn't matter. It's very huge. But if you have mechanism to select from all the combination the best ones, then you have done. This is the problem, because all the optimization models, they're designed just to overcome this. So that any problem, have a solution by brute force. But the problem is we're never able to do that for reasonably high dimensions. Anyway, that's the question for next discussion. Sorry.
Yes, Vasily, I would like to a couple of words to say that the results of this paper much deeper than you speak now. So the results consider first important contribution of representing chemical compounds by a small description. It's not obvious way, because it's not only represent by small description chemical compounds, but also reconstruct chemical compounds by this description. It's a very important and very complicated problem. And the second one, this is all this done for generating chemical compounds with some energy of binding energy. And this semi-supervised approach allows to do it with some threshold of this binding energy. It's also important stuff. And the third one, all these best compounds are going through the procedure of molecular modeling just to to find and to prove that they are really good for further drug design. So it's a very complicated problem and not only just simple what you
of course detail. I do understand, but yeah. Nevertheless there could be some more questions. Minimal energy, okay, there could be just two local minima, you just got one and you will never go to the second one. Okay, I don't understand deeply the problem as such, so I'm a little bit naive on that, but just the question to clarify the point. Thank you very much. Anyway, it's okay, an excellent presentation.
The presentation is nice and we have a lot for potential discussion. But we need probably to go according to the schedule.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay, so thanks for interesting question and thanks for interesting discussion. And we go to the last presentation at this session, which is presentation number 6 and should be done by Tatiana Kim, as I understand, and will be on development of an adaptive motion controller for a two-wheeled mobile robot along a color contrast line based on the use of RL technology. So, yes, please.
Good afternoon. Can you see my screen?
Yes.
Good afternoon, dear colleagues. Let me introduce myself. My name is Tatiana Kim, and I'm a PhD student of United Institute of Informatics Problems in Minsk. Today, I would like to present article development of an adaptive motion control for a two-wheel mobile robot along a color contrast line based on reinforcement learning technology. Written by me and my scientific director, candidate of engineering science, Grigory Prokopovich. So what's the topic of the research? The purpose of the research is a development process of an adaptive motion controller for a two wheels mobile robot along a contrast line. The controller learning process took place on the basis of the mobile robot using reinforcement learning technology. I just use RL. It was implemented in MATLAB Simulink. For learning algorithm, we choose TD3 method. Then we created a reward function to minimize the distance between the center of the robot and angle of the robot position and the tangents to the current section of the contrast line. The object of the research is the robot training mobile robot with a different drive, which is supposed to move along the color contrast line. Control system, it's a classic servo drive, including 3 color sensor and EP the controller that controls the angle of speed of the wheels. Previously, we have experience and we are carried out of the automatic tuning of the specified PID controller using the software model MATLAB called Automatic Tune PID, and then the application of genetic algorithm. Some words about PID controller. Sometimes the selection of the coefficients, it's a rather long process, which doesn't always lead to success, since there are a chance of overshoot. In closed loop control systems, the controller use status observation to improve performance and correct random noise and errors. This concept is easy to put into words, but it will be difficult to implement, since the model can be highly non-linear or have large space of states and actions. So there is also a problem related to the fact that for each line trace, it's required to find the corresponding bit value. And this problem can be quickly solved by using RL, reinforcement learning. It is one of the machine learning methods for solving control problem in complex technical system that can't or can be problematically described in an analytical form. In RL, the object of research in studied as a result of which an artificial neural network in general that can be simulate the desired object. In table one, we can see several type of actor-critic learning algorithms. Actor-critic agents use either stochastic actor or deterministic actor with a value critic or a co-value critic. We have chosen the TD3 method, which contains a deterministic actor and a co-value critic. On the next slide, I will explain why we choose it. Before starting the learning process, it's required to create a virtual environment for a function of a mobile robot and interface for interacting with it. Next, we should configure the agent model from the library from MATLAB. To implement the agent, the TD3 algorithm was chosen, which is characteristic by the fact that in addition to the agent, which offers specified action of the actor on session in indication of the sensory system. Then 10 U entities are to use two critics that form a long-term reward. Next, agent is configured and format. The final stage is training and verification of the result of the training agent. The important state in RL is created a reward function as affect the performance and the agents, its relation to goal and the mobile robot seek to achieve. On the slide, you can see two criteria. It's taken into account as a reward for a communicate action. The first, the distance R from the center of the robot XY to the nearest unvisited point X null and Y null of the ellipse located on the line is calculated using the formula for calculating for distance between two points. It's formula one. The closer the agent, the more reward it will receive, the fewer the less reward. The second calculates the angle phi between the tangents to the ellipse at the point x0 and y0, where the robot should be. And the robot guide using formula two. Since our reward singles consist is two single signals and combined into one scalar. Then we determinize that the distance between the line and the robot of the paramount importance as the resulting angle phi. We reduce in influence to get reward. The next stage is agent implementation. Implementation of the environment. There we need 2 points. It's first of all position of the robot and indication from the sensor. Then we need to create agent implementation. In this process of training, the agent use the following data. The reading of the sensor in the middle of the line. This consists three-line sensor. The distance for sensor of mobile robot, the center of the robot. Contrast line, as well as the angle between the normal and nearest section of the line and the direction movement the mobile robot itself. The next stage is stop criteria. It's used to reduce learning time. Each episode of the learning process can stop if the simulation exists the time allotted for movement along full ellipse, and the robot has existed the distance to the center of the ellipse line. During each episode, the agent chooses an action. After the end, he updates his parameter based on actions and receives the maximum reward. In this picture, the main block is RL agent, where consists deterministic actor, which took state and Q value critics, which took state and some actions every epoch. Then agent use algorithm learning. For learning algorithm took 2 hours 15 minutes. Then the results obtain the significance and comparison this with the previous work. In this table, comparison the result obtained earlier by the GA method with a new result obtained by the reinforcement learning method. We can conclude that the later method reduced the number of episodes and training time by several times. According of our observation, the robot with a new coefficients move more evenly that with the genetic algorithm, there are no interrupt and bones. In this graph, shows that the highest reward, it's a blue line, it's more 1,100, and the average reward is more 700 units, where the robot can be drive an elliptical curve in 1 second, minimizing the distance to the curve. Conclusion, we using the reinforcement learning algorithm, the optimal value of the bit controller for this robot were selected. We created a virtual environment for observing the robot. Learning was implemented using the TD3 method, using a deterministic actor and co-value critic. As a result, the tuned PID controller allowed the mobile robot to accurately move along the curved contrast line at a speed of 0.66 meter per second. I think it's everything that I need to show and speak. I will be glad to answer any question. Thank you for attention.
Okay, thank you for the nice presentation. And are there maybe one short question, just very short? So no questions. So in this case, I would like to thank to all the speakers, and I hope that every participant supports me in this. And so my personal opinion is the session was successful. So we have 100% of presentations planned, and the spectrum of presentations was really wide. The results for me were quite interesting. And the only thing I would like to say is some words of apology for the chairman of the next session because of a small delay with realizing this schedule for this session. So thanks to everybody for participation and all the best. Bye.
Thank you, dear chairman. Yes, so it was very intensive session, and so I was also very satisfied with this. Well, actually, so yes, we need to avoid our break because we need to be in schedule. And now, just after a small tearing, in 40 seconds, we'll come back for the next session. So jump to your coffee and come back in 40 seconds.